one of the reasons we think sign language grammars look the way they do is because of iconicity. And that's the fact that many signs in sign languages look like their meaning. So it won't surprise people to know, for example, that in BSL, this is the sign for eat, this is the sign for drink, this is a sign meaning time, okay? So these signs are what are called iconic signs. There's a resemblance between the form of the sign and the meaning. But it's not just the individual signs in sign languages that also have this form-meaning resemblance, but also the grammatical structures of the language. So for example, this is a sign meaning go to a place in BSL. If I repeat that sign multiple times, that means I often go to that place. So you can see that the repetition of the sign meaning I go to a place often, okay, is also a kind of iconic relationship. There's a relationship there between the form and meaning. Sign Morph is a 5-year research project here at the University of Birmingham, funded by the European Research Council. The aim of Sign Morph is really to use sign languages of deaf communities to answer one of the most important questions in linguistics, in the study of languages. And that is, how are languages similar and different from each other? And why are there these similarities? And why are there these differences in the languages of the world? So in Sign Morph, we're going to try and answer this question by comparing 3 major categories of signing communities. We want to look at older national sign languages like British Sign Language that have been used for 200 or 300 years and are used by an entire national deaf community across the 4 countries of the United Kingdom. We want to compare BSL with a sign language like Katakolok, which is a sign language that has also been used across multiple generations, but within a small village setting in which the majority of deaf people have acquired that language from birth.
In comparing BSL and Katakolok, there's lots of similarities, but there's also lots of differences, as one would expect when comparing any 2 languages. It really depends on what you're interested in. One example is, for example, how space is used. Both languages do use space, but they use it differently when referring to time, for example. So in Katakolok, the expression of time is related to the sun. So 2 o'clock in the afternoon would be a point to where the sun is normally at this point of the day. And the signs morning and evening would be related to the sunrise and the sunset, so it's very directional. The way we do this in BSL is quite detached from the sun. So there's differences in the signs here. Within the Sign Morph project, we're obviously interested in morphology. So we'll be looking into that and see how this is affected by a social context of these 2 different environments and communities, and how a social context and networks and morphological structure influence each other in their respective languages.
And we want to compare both of those with a 3rd community, which is the emerging sign language communities that, unlike Katakolok and BSL, are fairly young languages. So for example, Arjun is from Nepal, and Nepali sign language is a much younger sign language than Katakolok and BSL, having emerged, we believe, since the 1960s, since the first schools for deaf children were opened in Nepal.
I have a background in research related to sign language linguistics and deaf studies. Specifically, my MSc at UCL, I conducted research focusing on British Sign Language, specifically related to numerical incorporation. So that was part of my background in researching sign language. Also in Nepal, I did some sign language research related to morphology. For example, my research included this sign that means father. Oh, sorry, means man. Yeah, so this sign means father. So this sign, father, is made by combining 2 signs. These 2 sign morphemes becomes a new word. So that's an example of something that I was researching related to Nepali Sign Language. How two signs or two morphemes could become a word. So, kind of studying morphology earlier in my research career has related to my work now with Sign Morph. So now, being involved in this project and continuing to work, including Nepali Sign Language in this research, has been a great continuation of that.
The research project has both theoretical and applied or practical implications. First of all, in terms of the theory, by collecting the data and doing the studies that we propose to do in Sign Morph, we hope that it will begin to answer that fundamental question that we have in linguistics, why the languages of the world are in some ways similar to each other and in other ways different from each other. So there's that theoretical interest. But we also have some practical and applied dimensions. So for example, Arjun, who's working on our project, comes from the Nepali Sign Language community. So if Arjun does some work on describing the grammar of Nepali Sign Language, then this will have applications in the education of deaf children, the training of interpreters, the training of teachers of the deaf. So if we understand how Nepali Sign Language works, the structure of the language, then we can prepare better materials for training teachers and training interpreters, and also for use within the education of deaf children.